bow before you in worship and adoration of who you are, and for your splendor and your majesty and your glory and your power and your might. Lord, you are high above the heavens. Lord, your ways are higher than our ways and your thoughts than our thoughts. And we thank you, Lord, that your thoughts are good toward us, Lord, that you are for us, Lord. And Lord, though the enemy come in one direction, he will flee in seven, Lord. These are the promises. So Lord, we know that we are in a fight, but Lord, thank you that you are equipping us. You are giving us more and more keys, Lord, to unlock the secrets of the kingdom, Lord. Not only to set us free, Lord, but to take those keys and to help set others free, Lord. That is our heart's desire, Lord. That's your desire when you said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor, to proclaim liberty to the captives, the opening of the prison to them that are bound, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Thank you, Lord, that that is your anointing, and we ask for your anointing to be upon us in this time. In your precious name, amen.
What happened?
You just had mute on.
Amen. Well, everyone, Shabbat Shalom. Good to see you all. Good to see your name, some of you who I can't see, but welcome to our fourth study in building the right foundations in life. Liz is not with us today, but thanks again, Gina, for filling in for us, for her, for hosting us. And once again, it's my honor and privilege to bring something from the Word. Liz has asked me just to recap a little bit where we have come from. For those who have been with us all the time and those who haven't, we actually started off just during the time of Passover, just after Passover. And we talked about the deliverance from Egypt and then the journey in the wilderness and how the Lord was with the Israelites, how they were on a journey to the promised land and some of the difficulties that they encountered in the wilderness, including themselves, including their complaining, including having to learn to trust God in a new way. And then we... Then the next series we talked about was conquering the land. And we looked at the book of Joshua, Yehoshua, which is the same word as Yeshua, which means salvation. And how, on one hand, the Lord said, every place you've set your foot, I've given you. And yet, on the other hand, he said, I'm not going to give you the land overnight, but little by little. I will give you the land. And so that tension between, as I said, the Hebrew word Joshua or Yeshua means salvation. And I talked about salvation in our lives. It's not only an event, a one-off event on the cross when the Lord said it is finished, but it is a process. It's something that we learn, as it says, as Paul said in Philippians 2, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. So it's a working out. It's applying the cross to our past. Yes, all things are passed away, but we've got to reckon. We've got to put to death. It's a process. I wish it was overnight. I wish it was that simple. And then we did a third series called, actually a third and a fourth series on authority, the authority of the Lord and knowing our authority in the Lord. And now we've been doing a series on foundation based on the Lord's parable about building our lives either on a rock or on the sand. And the Lord likened it to a man building his house on a rock or on a sand. And he said, the building is those who hear my words and do it, or those who hear my words and don't do it. And it's, you know, it's not as easy as just being in a church, listening to the preacher say, love your enemies, and going out and doing it. It is a challenge. It is a challenge to obey. Well, and this series we've looked on different foundations, foundations of our identity. What kind of identity have we been building our lives on? Is it on false identities that we get from the world, from the devil, from his lies? Or is it based on what God says, the mirror, which is God's word? That is our true foundation. And who he says we are, we go with that. In spite of how we feel, in spite of our unworthiness, that is how we are to walk. And we're going to take it to the real, I believe, the real root, or rather the real foundation, and that's today's theme. We're building our lives on the cross. Now, I didn't plan this, but actually it's great timing to do this, because in 2 days' time, our whole country is going to go on shutdown because it's the most holiest day of the year. It's coronavirus day. No, it's not coronavirus day. Actually, a week ago, we went on closed down because of coronavirus. And it was supposed to be over a 3-week period. And they said, we'll renegotiate this closure depending on how the closure is doing. Well, after a week, it's not doing anything. In fact, the numbers are still spiking, and we got a record high of sick people in one day, 8,000 2 days ago. It had been averaging about 5,500 every day. Now it reached 8,000. So yesterday, a total closure of the country. And some of our ministers are saying we are on the brink of a catastrophe economically and just in the business sector. So, but this coming Monday night, Tuesday, we are closing down in a different way for the most holiest day of the year, which is Yom Kippur, which is the Day of Atonement. And the Day of Atonement was the one day of the year where the high priest, he took three animals. He took two goats and he took a bullock. And he would go into the Holy of Holies only on that day, but he would go in three times. The first time is when he would he would cleanse himself. Then he would lay his hands on the bullock. Then he would slay the bullock, take the blood, and then he would take a coal off the altar, go into the incense altar, put the coal on it, and the incense would turn into smoke, creating a kind of an image of the glory of God. And then he would put that blood on that altar. Then he would go out, he would cleanse himself again the second time, and then they would cast a lot for either the two goats, and the one that was chosen, they would put a red ribbon around it to know which one it was. Then he would lay hands on it and slay it and get the blood of that goat and take it in and put that blood on the altar before the Ark of the Covenant. And he would sprinkle it seven times. And then the third time, and by the way, that sprinkling was an atonement for him as the high priest that would, the words are not coming to me today, that would qualify him to be worthy to offer up the third time the blood for the nation. But before he did that, he would go out. I'm seeing a note saying, anyone else losing volume? Is that better? I've just turned my volume up. No, give me a thumbs up if you can hear me okay.
You've been perfect for me.
Okay. Excuse me. So the third time he would go out, wash himself again, and then he would lay his hands on, he would take the other goat, which was called the scapegoat. And he would lay his hands on that scapegoat and he would shoo the scapegoat out into the desert, never to come back. And then he would go back into the altar and spread some more blood before the ark. And this was within the veil of the Holy of Holies. And what an amazing day that was. When you think about what the book of Hebrews says. Now, what's interesting is I see Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, I actually see it as a kind of a second chance. You know, some rabbis say that the first Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement, was actually when Moses broke the Ten Commandments. You know what they say about Moses? He was the biggest sinner in the Bible because he broke all Ten Commandments in one moment. So, but what happened? The Lord, in his mercy, he, with his finger of fire, wrote out another 10 commandments. He atoned. And in that passage in Exodus 34, the Lord talks about, he shows Moses his mercy. He shows him his grace. He renews the covenant. And so this is a second chance. Yom Kippur, the day when all the sins are atoned for and covered. The word kippur means, from the word kapara, like the word kippah, a yarmulke, a kippah, a covering. And think of how that was fulfilled, and think about when the four evangelists, the gospel writers, wrote about the veil of the temple was rent in two. That is an incredible historical event. By the way, I think I've quoted this before, and I was actually trying to find it the other day, and I couldn't find it, but it is a legitimate quote from the Talmud and from the Mishnah, two Jewish commentaries, quote, the year 33 AD, as the Jewish people call it, CE, the common era, that was the, in that year, the scapegoat that was sent out into the wilderness for the first time and only time recorded in history, that scapegoat came back. And those two sources are not messianic sources, meaning they're not apologists trying to prove that Jesus is the Messiah. Far from it. So that is a quite interesting quotations. I remember reading that in a famous Scottish commentator, William Barclay. He quotes that, and I was trying to find it online the other day, and I couldn't find it. So if anyone can find that, I would like to get my hands on that. But friends, this was the day that the Lord offered himself up for our sins. Now, what's interesting is 40 or so years later, the temple was destroyed. What do Jewish people do? By the way, that was a crisis for the Jewish leaders. Can you imagine having no temple, no priesthood? Because according to Josephus, all the priestly records that were in the temple were all burned up when Titus and the Romans burned and destroyed the temple. So now there's no priestly records. So there's no sacrifice for sins. There's no priesthood. And then 60 something years later, when Hadrian, the Roman emperor, expelled the Jews from Jerusalem, now they've got no holy city. This was a major crisis for Judaism. No temple, no priesthood, no sacrifice for sins, and now no holy city of Jerusalem. What was their Judaism without that? It was a big crisis. So not long after that, a new form of Judaism was born called rabbinic Judaism, if you've heard of that. And basically that is where the priests were replaced by rabbis. The rabbis became the authority. Synagogues became the central focal point instead of the temple, because there was no temple. And prayer and good works became central in Judaism in place of sacrifice for sins, because there's no temple and no altar and no priesthood. And friends, that is basic mainstream Judaism until today. Synagogues, rabbis, and prayer and good works. And when Yom Kippur comes in a couple of days, what Jewish people are going to do, based on Leviticus chapter 16 and Leviticus chapter 23, where it says you are to afflict your souls or afflict yourselves. Now, what does that mean? You know, there's many different interpretations to that, but usually it's to fast and to abstain from anything pleasurable or anything connected with life. That's why Jews are forbidden to wear leather on Yom Kippur. So you won't see them wearing any leather clothes or leather shoes. And what they do is they fast and they pray. So the question is that enough? Does that atone for their sins? And I heard recently what's a really interesting interpretation of what it means to afflict yourself. And the interpretation was simply, and by the way, he was a believer who gave this interpretation. He said, really, to afflict yourself should be to realize that there's nothing that we can do to atone for our sin. We come to the end of ourselves, like the Apostle Paul in Romans 7, when he looked at himself and he said, I want to do good, but evil is right there with me. And what I want to do, I don't. And what I don't want to do, I do. And then he says this, O wretched man that I am. And I think that that's what it means to afflict ourselves, is to see that, again, quoting Paul, he says, I know that in me, in my flesh, dwells no good thing. Now, this is not a message about, hey, let's see how bad we can see ourselves. No, because, but what it is to see our hopelessness, to atone for ourselves and to attain any sense of righteousness. You know, the old saying, you don't put the cart before the horse. What do I mean by that? I mean that you and I, we are called to do good works. We are called to, I mean, that's the basis of the parable. When the Lord said, if you hear my words and do it, you're building your life on a rock. But the problem with that is if we haven't dealt with this issue of atonement, the foundation, you know what we'll try to do subtly? We will try to do good works. We will try to earn God's goodness. We will try to earn God's love, and we will try to earn his righteousness. And it's something that we cannot earn. It is something that has been given as a gift for us. And that's what Yom Kippur points to. The scapegoat. That is the only time of the year that it's talked about the scapegoat. The goat, in Hebrew, it's called Lazazel. And it is symbolic of someone who is, well, we all know what a scapegoat is, don't we? Someone who is blamed when he shouldn't be blamed. And friends, this is the beautiful message of salvation. This is the name of Jesus, salvation. He became the scapegoat for us. The curtain was rent. He is the fulfillment of Jeremiah chapter 23, where there is a messianic prophecy which says, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will send a man upon the earth. He will rule in righteousness and justice. And this is what his name shall be. Adonai Tzidkenu. And that means the Lord, our righteousness. So this man who is going to rule on the earth is the Lord. And he is our righteousness. And this is imputed to us by faith and faith alone. This is what Paul says in Romans 5. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ our Lord. This was the great passage that Martin Luther brought about the Reformation when he saw what was happening in Catholicism with all of the efforts and all the good works and the hope of one day, maybe when I die, my good works will outweigh my bad works. A lot of religious people, even in the church, are still living with that hope. But Paul takes it a step further where he talks about assurance. We don't want to, remember what I said last week about the little daisy, you know, he loves me. You know. Well, the same can be said about our eternal salvation. Today I was good, I'm in. Yesterday was a bad day, the next day I don't live up to what I should. I'm out. Is that how God wants us to live? No. So we need to have this assurance that our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And that's what we say on Rosh Hashanah, the new year. May your name be written in the Book of Life. Well, that's what the Jewish people say. May your name be written in the Book of Life. We can say our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Amen. Give me a thumbs up if you say amen. All right. Now, last week, I think it was the week before, I touched on what the Hebrew meaning of the word Hebrew is. And that word literally means to go over or to cross over. We say ivri from the word ivrit, Hebrew. And it's the same root word as over, which means to cross over. And of course, Abraham was the first Hebrew. He crossed over from Ur to Canaan. And I talked about how the book of Hebrews, that is the theme, crossing over from earthly to heavenly, from the old to the new, from the holy place into the Holy of Holies, from infancy to maturity. And one of the things that the writer talks about in Hebrews chapters 9, 10, and 11 is he gets into this talking about how the priests brought sacrifice day after day, but then he turns it and he talks about, but this one sacrifice, one eternal sacrifice, once and for all sacrifice. But he doesn't stop there. He wants us to go over, and he talks about going over from the Aaronic priesthood to the Melchizedek priesthood. Now, I'm sure we all know about this mysterious man in Genesis 14, Melchizedek, as we say in Hebrew, Melchizedek. Melchi, my king, Tzedek, of righteousness. We know that this man, Melchizedek, mystery man, whom Abraham paid a tithe to, do you remember what Melchizedek brought out to Abraham? He actually brought him the bread and the wine. He brought communion. Very interesting. The Aaronic priesthood, really, when you look at that, it's all about sacrifice for sins. The whole priestly system. Melchizedek, that priesthood is a priesthood of communion, meaning that God doesn't want to just forgive us our sins. He wants to have communion with us. He wants a deep relationship with us. And that's where a lot of believers, they struggle. I know a lot of Catholics. I have a lot of friends who are Catholics. And this is some of their struggle. You know, they will say their Hail Marys. They will confess their sins. The question is do they know the communion of the Lord? And sometimes they get hung up and they have to ask the saints to pray for them. They have to ask Mary to pray for them. They don't know what it says in Hebrews chapter 4, let us come boldly to the throne of grace, because there's a new and living way made possible for us so that we can go in. Because the third time that high priest went in, and the second time he cleansed himself, the third time he made it possible for all the sons of Israel to come in, as it were, not physically, but to be at one with God. This is deep. This is rich. But this is communion. What's interesting is sometime later, when David was capturing Jerusalem, he actually had a tabernacle. This, of course, is way before the temple, the Aaronic priesthood, the tabernacle in the wilderness. And even David, this was probably about 50 years before his son Solomon built the temple. But David, apart from the tabernacle of Moses, David had a tabernacle. He set up a tabernacle. And do you know what was interesting about David's tabernacle? Is that it wasn't just sacrifice of sins, but he also brought out the bread and the wine. And women were allowed to partake, and Gentiles were allowed to partake. And this is what I believe it was James said on the day of Pentecost. This is what was written. And he quotes the prophet Amos, and he quotes the prophet Joel. I will raise up again the fallen tabernacle of David, where Jews and Gentiles, male and female, not only can find forgiveness of sins, but communion. Can you imagine David standing giving out bread and wine. You know, he was the king. No one can go near a king. But he broke the bread. And Melchizedek, he brought the bread and the wine to Abraham. There's another story that is illustrating this. And if you've got your Bible, go to John chapter 4 with me. John 4 is the beautiful story of the woman of Samaria. And this, again, shows us a beautiful story about how the Lord, look at verse 4, chapter 4, verse 4. I love that verse. What does it say? He must needs go through Samaria. The Lord was on a mission. What was his mission? His mission was to seek and to save the lost. He was on a mission. He was going to single out this Samaritan woman. In verse 5, he comes to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. And Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat on the well. It was about the sixth hour. So he was weary. He was thirsty. And there came a woman of Samaria, also thirsty, to draw water. I love how it starts, two thirsty people. And we're going to see by the end of this story, no one was thirsty. Jesus said to her, give me to drink. You know, it's interesting that phrase, give me to drink. Look at verse 6, Jacob's well was there. Do you remember what Jacob did when he was in Samaria? He poured out water on the altar that he made for the Lord after the Lord changed his name to Israel. He poured out water. Why would anyone want to pour out water? You know why, I believe? It's a water offering. It's like you're saying, God, I want to please you. That's why we give that's why the ancient peoples gave sacrifices on the altar. They call it food for the gods. When you put the sacrifices and it burns up, you are hoping that that sweet smelling fragrance will go up and your God will be satisfied and pleased. And that's why Jacob pours out water and oil. He wants to quench God's thirst. He wants to please God. And I love how John mentions Jesus saying, give me to drink. Jesus, the Son of God, is saying, give me to drink. Verse 8, for his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy meat. Then said the woman of Samaria, how is it that you, being a Jew, ask to drink of me, a Samaritan woman? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus said to her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that says to you, give me to drink, you would have asked of him and he would give you living water. So Jesus is talking about a gift of God. What is the gift that he's talking about? Well, she's talking to him. She doesn't know it yet, but he is the gift. Verse 11, the woman said to her, sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From where will you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank, and his children and his cattle? Jesus said to her, whoever drinks this water shall thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman said to her, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come here to draw. And Jesus, okay, so he's saying, okay, there's a gift, there's unquenchable waters, but now the Lord is saying, okay, first, go and call your husband and come. And the woman said, I have no husband. So she was being honest now. And again, this is communion. This is this woman having deep communion with the Son of God. She doesn't know it yet, but he honors her for her honesty. Look how he answered. Jesus said to her, you have said well that I have no answer. He commends her. Verse 18, for you have had five husbands, and the one whom you have now is not your husband. In that you have said truly. Now the woman, her perception is starting to wake up. And she says, I perceive you're a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain. And you say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. So this woman, she knew a lot about her religion. She knew a lot about the Jewish religion, because the Samaritans believed that the true place of the temple was in Samaria. The Jews believed that it was in Jerusalem. That was probably the biggest division that they had between them. And she knew about Jacob's well. She knew a lot about her religion and culture and everything. Look what Jesus says in verse 21. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you shall neither in this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship what you don't know, but we worship what we know, for salvation is of the Jews. And he reiterates what he's saying now in verse 23. The hour is coming, and now is. And now is. When the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeks such as to worship. God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. Friends, do you know that the only way you could worship in those days, if you were an Israelite, was geographically in one place and one place alone? It was in St. Paul's Cathedral in Rome. No, I'm kidding. It was in Jerusalem. There was only one place. And once you got to Jerusalem, there was only one way you could worship. How was that? Through the sacrificial system. And there were five main sacrifices. Some of them were voluntary. Some of them were mandatory. The five main sacrifices were the burned offering, the grain offering, the peace offering, the sin offering, and the trespass offering. So remember that there was only one place and only one way to worship, and that was through the sacrificial system. But what is Jesus saying? He's saying, woman, the time is coming, and now is, that you don't have to go to Jerusalem. You don't have to go here to Samaria. But the true worshipers are going to worship in spirit and in truth. And he says the Father is seeking those kind of people. Now, what does he mean to worship in spirit and truth? Well, basically what he's saying you don't have to make it a geographical trip three times a year to Jerusalem. Although, you know, I'm a tour guide. I shouldn't be saying this. I should be saying the opposite, but I got to be honest here. So he's saying you don't have to come to Jerusalem to worship. You can worship where you are in spirit, number one. And number two, you don't have to take a sacrifice. You don't have to go through the sacrificial system. Why? Because the gift of God is here now. Jesus, he is the fulfillment of all those sacrifices. He is the burnt offering, which totally burns up for God's satisfaction. He is the grain offering, which is a kind of a thanksgiving offering. He is a peace offering, shared with the priest. He is the sin offering, which atones for our guilt, our sin, defilement, or death. And he is the trespass offering for any unintentional sins. And friends, think about it where you are, whether you're in America or Canada or Scotland or Australia or Israel. That means by faith today, in the Spirit, you can offer up to the Father the gift, Jesus, and say, Father, I thank you for your gift. I thank you that he is my guilt offering. He is my sin offering. All my sins have been laid on him. He is the scapegoat. He is my trespass offering. He is the bullock. He's the scapegoat. And friends, Jesus talked about communion with this woman of Samaria. Because if you read on, look at verse 25, the woman said to him, I know that when Messiah comes, who is called the Mashiach or the Christ, when he has come, he will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I that speak to you am he. I am. This is the I am. And he knows everything about her. And he doesn't condemn her. That's why he met in the middle of the day. He didn't want to shame her when no one else was around. Because look at verse 27. The next verse. And upon this came his disciples and marveled that he talked with a woman. And said, what are you seeking? Why do you talk with her? The woman then left her water pot. And she went away into the city and said to the men, come, see a man which told me all things that I ever did. Is not this the Messiah? Then they went out of the city and came to him. In the meanwhile, his disciples prayed to him, saying, Master, eat. And he said, I have food to eat that you don't know of. Therefore said the disciples one to another, has any man brought him anything to eat? And Jesus said, my food is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. And then he said, don't say that there are 4 months and then comes the harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields. They are already white unto harvest. Friends, this was the beautiful end to the story. She left her pot, her jar. She was no longer thirsty. She was satisfied. She tasted the living waters. And Jesus was satisfied because this was his meat, his food, to do the will of the Father. And friends, as we get this great foundation of the cross and what it means, the depth of forgiveness, taking away our guilt. Last week we talked about shame, the depths of the shame. The depths of all of the defilement and how sin has defiled us and how we have defiled others. The blood of Jesus covers all of this. And for the Jewish people on Yom Kippur, they're going to be afflicting their souls and they're going to be crying out that God would have mercy on them. And you know what? God still has a covenant with them. He still has a covenant with them, but they don't yet know that he is the gift, the unspeakable gift. They don't know that he is the living waters, that he is the Messiah who has atoned for their sins. So this Yom Kippur, we Messianic Jews, we celebrate. We celebrate. Now we also pray and fast because we want to pray for our brothers, our nation. We want to pray that they see the Messiah. They see that he is the one, that one day they will look upon him whom they have pierced and they shall weep and mourn. But in the meantime, they have this veil, and we pray that that veil will be taken away, and they will see, and they will come to know who the true one is, and that Jesus as a living Messiah, because he's not just dead in the grave, he's risen, that he can break through religion and culture, just like he did with this woman of Samaria. And he can break through gender and race. And he can satisfy us. She looked for the satisfaction in relationships. Obviously, she tried to get deep satisfaction through men. Other people through alcohol or work or fantasy or whatever. We all have those issues that we fight. Jesus is the one. He is the one that satisfies us, gives us the living waters. And the paradox, because, you know, I was thinking of what he said, whoever drinks of these waters will thirst again, but whoever drinks of the waters that I give him shall never thirst again. And yet, in the Sermon on the Mount, he actually said, blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness. So it's kind of almost like, on one hand, it seems like a contradiction or a paradox. But the other thing that the Lord brings out is the Father is seeking those who will seek him. So there's he does the seeking, but we have to do our part as well. We have to do the seeking. He will satisfy us, but we have to hunger and thirst after him as well. And this is our foundation. So to put the horse before the cart, everyone, the horse is the finished works of what Jesus did for us. That's what the word vicar or vicarious means, on our behalf. It's nothing we can do. We have nothing in us. It's all about him. But once we accept that foundation, that becomes our great motivator. That becomes the fuel, the juice, the oil, the living waters that stir us up. So that, like Jesus, it becomes our food to do the will of God the Father. This is our foundation, not the other way around. God forbid that we should try and please God. No, we are pleasing in his sight through Jesus. We are accepted in the beloved, Paul says to the Ephesians. We got to get that. And that's what it means to go from the Aaronic priesthood to the Melchizedek priesthood, to move on from the sacrificial system. Yes, it's done once and for all, and go in and have sweet communion by the body and the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Ron. Again, is a very powerful message and very meaningful and timely, considering the fact that we're heading, here in these states, we're heading into our own holiday season with Thanksgiving and Christmas. It's just preparing our hearts and our minds and getting us in line. And me personally, we're my little Bible study, we're starting to study Matthew chapter 7. So again, it all ties together with where's your heart and building your relationship and being sincere and true to the Father. So thank you. All right, let's go ahead and open it up for comments, questions. Anybody? Go ahead and start asking and raising your hands. I'll unmute everyone. And if anybody has anything now. All right. Nanny, anybody? Questions, comments? All right. I don't see anybody raising their hands.
Well, that's okay. That's okay. Because you know what? It might be a good idea to just worship God for what he, and thank him for you know, what we've just been talking about. Let me pray. Lord God, we just worship you, and we just thank you for for you are all wise in sending your son in the likeness of man under Pontius Pilate, living under the days of the Romans, born a Jew, and coming through the manger as a baby. Lord, it was just incredible, your plan of salvation. And here we are 2,000 years later, experiencing the blessing of that, the freedom, the redemption, the mercy seat, the covering, the atonement. Thank you, Lord, for the fulfillment of those different sacrifices that how Jesus was our burnt offering, how he made it possible that you, God, were totally satisfied with his blood. Thank you, Lord, that he is our guilt offering and our sin offering, and how any defilement, any death was covered and atoned for. Thank you that he was our trespass offering, any unintentional sins, and how he was a substitute as a recompense for the offended party, and how he is our recompense. Thank you, Lord, that when the high priest offered a bull, he offered up for both himself and his family. And thank you, Lord, when you offered up yourself, it was for your family and it was for the world. And we bless you and we worship you and we thank you, Lord. And we thank you that a way has been made through the veil, through the Holy of Holies, by your blood. Thank you, Lord, that we can come boldly to your throne anytime, Lord, as your children. And I pray for all of us, Lord, I pray that we would all rise up with the greater revelation of the depth of what was accomplished on Calvary on that Day of Atonement. I pray for greater revelation, Lord. Burn it into our hearts that we are totally accepted, and that we can, you are the Melchizedek. You are the priest who gives us the bread and the wine, your body and your blood to sustain us as we go through this world. And as we hunger and seek after you, Lord, we will be filled. We will be filled. That's your promise, Lord. And I pray for all of us, as we're hungering, as we're thirsting, Lord, that we would not be discouraged, that we would have you as our goal. We would have you, Lord. And we would, like the psalmist said, one thing that I desire and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, that we would worship you and you alone, Lord, knowing, Lord, that when we put you in place, then the blessings will flow like Psalm 23. Surely goodness and mercy will follow us. We won't even have to follow it. It will follow us. So I pray that for my brothers and sisters, your blessing, that Yivarechecha Adonai v'yishmarecha, Ya'er Adonai panav alecha v'yichonecha, Yisa Adonai panav alecha v'yasim lecha shalom. The Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you shalom, peace, wholeness, well-being in his precious son's name. Amen.